For hundreds of millions of years, horseshoe crabs have been crawling around the ocean floor. Coming ashore to mate in the spring, these living fossils are synced to the rhythms of the tides. Today, migratory shorebirds, sea turtles, and other ocean animals depend on horseshoe crabs for food. They are a keystone species at the heart of many coastal ecosystems in Asia and along the east coast of North America. Despite having survived ice ages and asteroids, these long-lived animals might finally be on their way out. And if they disappear, the consequences could be lethal, not just for the many species that depend on them, but for humans too. The horseshoe crab has evolved a powerful mechanism for protecting itself from infection. When bacteria sneaks past a horseshoe crab's shell, cells in the crab's blood send out a chemical that clots around the invader, stopping it in its tracks. And it's this property that makes horseshoe crab blood invaluable to the medical industry and to just about every human alive today.
It's used by the biomedical industry to test things that go into your body, whether it be blood or heart valves, to make sure that they're not contaminated.
It's currently the only FDA-approved method that ensures vaccines, various drugs, and medical devices are free of toxic bacteria that might otherwise harm or kill us.
And as a result, thousands of horseshoe crabs are bled every year to get this, and then they're released.
It's estimated that over 500,000 crabs are bled every year in the United States, each one contributing about a third of their blood before being returned to the ocean. This catch-and-release system supposedly leads to few crab deaths, so while American fishermen who harvest horseshoe crabs as bait have to limit their catch, the medical industry hasn't been subject to quotas.
What we don't know is whether there's some sublethal effects that may cause mortality later on, or sublethal effects that may affect their behavior in such a way as to alter their population magnitude.
In recent years, people have noticed that horseshoe crab numbers are dropping. In fact, the Atlantic horseshoe crab is currently listed as vulnerable by the International Union for Conservation of Nature, one step down from endangered. And the three other species of horseshoe crabs have started to disappear from many of their usual haunts in Asia. Global warming and habitat loss are probably at play here, but there's a growing concern that the practice of bleeding the crabs might also be a factor in their declining numbers. While the race is on to create an FDA-approved synthetic alternative, some scientists are exploring how the bleeding process might be stressing horseshoe crab populations.
So we are looking at the industry standard procedures and trying to replicate them as close as we can, and then returning these animals into their natural environment with transmitters to see if there's any impacts to these horseshoe crabs, and then we're looking at it in the laboratory to try to isolate which variables they are.
Our goal is to make sure that this is a sustainable process so that, you know, for years to come, we can use this valuable product without harming the population.
So throughout the biomedical bleeding process, horseshoe crabs are exposed to three different big variables.
What do we call stressors? They're out of water for a while, they're at high temperatures, and they remove some blood. And so we're trying to examine each of these stressors independently.
We went and collected about 28 horseshoe crabs through scuba diving in Great Bay Estuary in New Hampshire.
Half of them we bled the way the industry does it, and half of them we did not. They were the controls.
And then the next day, we actually put on our ultrasonic transmitters and we release them back into the bay where we can keep track of their behavior.
Dr. Watson and Meghan Owings have identified a few key findings. They saw a 14% death rate among their horseshoe crabs, a rate similar to earlier studies. When it comes to the three main stressors, they found that it was the combination of two or three that had the biggest impact on the surviving crabs' activity levels. And though the effects were more pronounced in the lab, in the field they were most pronounced in females and within the first month after release.
We also discovered early in the season, their hemocyanin levels seem to be very low because they really haven't eaten all winter long. Hemocyanin being the respiratory pigment they use for transporting oxygen.
Lower hemocyanin levels mean the crabs are in a more fragile state.
And so if you were to capture these animals and bleed them in the spring, which is when it's most convenient because that's when they're breeding, it might have more of a negative impact on them than later in the summer, because during the summer they're feeding and making more hemocyanin.
So we are starting a new experiment and seeing how feeding them different dietary supplements might be able to boost their hemocyanin concentrations.
Dr. Watson and Meghan Owings also plan on studying the crab's recovery of their blood volume over time, using radiography to peer inside the animals. Ultimately, they hope to share their data with bleeding facilities to help them work in a more sustainable way.
There's something that makes you want to preserve these animals because they've been around so long. I'd hate to see them disappear after being here for 450 million years.